All right, today we're going to go through a short propagation review, which I'm sure will in fact be review for a lot of you, and cover some newer content for some of you. We'll be revisiting all of these methods covered today throughout the rest of our course. So first, what is plant propagation? The process of creating new plants from a variety of sources. Simply put, we are taking old plants and somehow making new plants. We're mainly talking about seeds, cuttings, and bulbs, although there are more types of plant propagation that are a bit outside of the scope of this course, but your reading this week will cover some of those methods. When we talk about plant propagation, it's easy to split propagation into two primary types: sexual propagation from seed and vegetative or asexual propagation. Let's talk a bit about both of them and then we'll compare and contrast a bit. So, seed is a specialized plant structure wherein each seed is capable of growing into a new plant. Here we have a little annual flower seed, Gomphrena, with a butterfly on it. So, most of the plants that I grow on my farm, for example, are grown from seed. Most easy annual plants are, in fact, grown from seed. So it's a way that a lot of gardeners get started in the world of plant propagation. Seed propagation most used in grains, vegetables, annual flowers, and a number of easy perennials. And of course, there's a number of plants that can be grown either from seeds or from cuttings. Sometimes we can have the choice to choose one or the other with the same results, but typically you are limited by one or the other. Propagation from seed is less common with woody plants. In the flower world, again, we call these woodies, shrubs, large shrubs, small trees, fruit and woody ornamentals. Seed propagation is also less common with difficult perennials, ferns, orchids, a number of plants with a higher barrier to entry for propagation. Vegetative propagation, on the other hand, involves various plant parts. There's no reproduction here, and there's only one parent plant. So your parent plant or your mother stock is the parent plant, and the offspring are genetically identical to this parent plant. Most common for fruit trees, woody ornamentals, difficult perennials. Let's compare and contrast some different factors involved with asexual versus sexual propagation. So, over here on the left, in asexual propagation, we're looking at a quick, more predictable outcome. As we will see throughout this course, we will use a bunch of plants that are pretty easy to propagate asexually. So let's think about a rosemary plant. We're going to be working with rosemary a bit this semester. So I'm taking a cutting of rosemary. I'm treating it. I am plopping it in some soil, more or less, and that cutting will quickly turn into a new plant. As opposed to sexual propagation, it's a slower, less predictable outcome. It takes time, and there are a lot of factors that could change the outcome. Asexual propagation, the labor cost per unit is often higher, whereas over here in sexual propagation with seeds, it's often a cheaper process. Asexual propagation is useful with seedless plants such as bananas, grapes, oranges. This is how we can propagate these plants. Whereas with sexual propagation, of course, seedless plants cannot be propagated by that means. In asexual propagation, no genetic diversity could mean more vulnerable to environment or pests. So, if we are taking a parent plant and essentially cloning it with cuttings, we are opening it up to a more vulnerable environment. Whereas with sexual propagation, more genetic diversity means these subsequent generations of plants are less susceptible to diseases and pests. Let's talk briefly about some common methods of vegetative propagation, including cuttings, division, layering, grafting, and tissue culture. Let's start with cuttings. This is often what people think of when they think of vegetative asexual propagation. And in fact, we'll be doing some cuttings throughout this course. And I'd say that in terms of asexual propagation, this is the main method that I rely on and that many commercial greenhouses rely on. So here we're looking at a picture of a geranium plant, actually, which is something I grow. Scented geranium is a great foliage for cut flowers, and it is super easy to propagate from cuttings. We often use rooting hormone for cuttings, and with this plant, you might not even need it. So this is just a basic picture here showing that essentially the process involves cutting off a part of the plant. We'll dive more into what stage is best for this type of cutting, what type of plant works, and how the process is done. But we're cutting a propagule from the parent plant, and we are rooting it in new medium. Division, on the other hand, is basically what it sounds like, taking a parent plant and essentially chopping it up into different smaller plants. So here we have a picture of a banana plant. This gardener is sticking a shovel in the ground, separating sections of this banana plant, trimming it up, and replanting it. We will be working with division somewhat this semester as well. You'll soon be getting dahlia tubers. They're, you know, bulbs, but they're called tubers that I have divided from larger dahlia clumps in order to get them off to you. So that's one way you'll be seeing division really shortly. Many perennial plants in the garden, especially old English cottage garden type flowers, are in fact propagated by division. And it's a really great way for the home gardener to invest minimal amounts of money and then divide and multiply their stock over the years. Layering is done in the ground, in the garden, or in greenhouses and nursery beds or large pots. There are many different kinds of layering, but as you'll see here at the top left, simple layering. This basically involves encouraging stems of the plant to form roots and therefore new growth in the surrounding areas in the soil. I'm about to do this with a bed of raspberries I have. So the raspberry canes are not quite dormant this time of year, which is surprising. This is a pretty warm garden that I'm growing in. And I'll in fact bend these canes over and re-root them, stick them in the soil where they will form new roots and grow new raspberry plants. It's great for a plant that you want to divide. It's not so great when it's an invasive plant that is doing this on its own without any human intervention. Grafting is something likely a lot of you have heard of or worked with. My introduction to grafting was with apple trees. So here we're showing a simple method of grafting involving scion and the rootstock, and this is done by hand. There are many mechanical ways of doing this, but essentially with apple trees, the rootstock, which is below ground, will determine the vigor and the size of the tree, whereas the scion is what determines the variety of the tree. So you might have a M10 rootstock that you're grafting to a Fuji scion, for example. Stem cuttings are the main type of cuttings that we'll be working with in this course. They involve hardwood cuttings, semi-hardwood, softwood, and herbaceous cuttings, depending on the time of year. We'll talk about what plants prefer which types of cuttings depending on the time of year, and often just depending on that plant's individual preferences. That is it for today. We will be diving in more throughout the semester, and your reading will help you catch up on some of these propagation factors.